God, by faith, we know your goodness will certainly be good unto us in the upcoming year. God, we thank you for this moment. We thank you for this privilege of preaching. Thank you, God, for what has transpired in our service thus far. We thank you, God, for this last Sunday of this wonderful year. Thank you that you allow us on this last day of this year to be in worship, to offer you praise and song and testimony. And now, God, we're looking to hear the last word from you on today, the last word on this year. We pray, God, that this will be a word that will bless, uprich, and encourage as we prepare to transition into this new and blessed and prosperous year. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Joshua, the first chapter, and I want to read for us this morning, verse 9. Joshua 1 and verse 9. You stand for the reading of the word. And it reads, "Have not I commanded thee? Be strong and of good courage. Be not afraid, neither be thou dismayed. For the Lord thy God is with thee, whithersoever thou goest." I want this today to talk from the subject, Providence for a New Year. Talk about providence for a new year. I read this week an encouraging post that was shared by a Facebook friend of mine, actually Dr. Heath Thomas, who was on staff at Oklahoma Baptist University. And in his post, he shared a blog from a gentleman by the name of Aaron Earls. Aaron Earls writes a blog for Lifeway Publishing in Nashville. But this very encouraging post by Aaron Earls dealt with some very noticeable facts and trends from 2017. One of the facts and trends he noticed was that globally, the most shared, bookmarked, and highlighted verse on the Bible app was Joshua chapter 1 and verse 9. Trends and research. And this is one of the benefits of technology when it comes to even the Bible. These Bible apps allow persons to track and research certain trends as it relates to the Bible in people's study. And so over the course of 2017, the most followed, followed verse in the Bible was Joshua chapter 1 and verse 9. Which led me to believe that obviously there are many people in our land who are looking for encouragement. Because this particular verse deals with Joshua and the children of Israel and people who are moving forward and getting the encouragement to know that you should be strong and be of good courage. For the Lord your God goes with you wherever you are going. But we also notice in his facts and trends that in the United States, the verse with the most interactions when it comes to the Bible app was Romans 8 and 28. All things work together for good. Amen. To them that love God and are called according to his purpose. And so when you notice that the verse that's gone to the most is Joshua 1 and 9. Be thou strong and of good courage, because the Lord goes with you wherever you go. But then you couple that with Romans 8 and 28 being the most interactive verse online, that all things work together for good. It leads me to believe that somewhere between Joshua and Romans, we get the encouragement to know that God goes with us. And if God goes with us, we can be sure that whatever we face, God is going to work it out for our good.
Amen.
The YouVersion, Aaron Earls says, of the Bible app, saw even more people turn to the Bible app than ever in 2017 to explore God's Word. In other words, and many of them took place in some very unexpected places. Downloads of the Bible app in India in 2017 increased by 228%. Downloads of the Bible app in Iraq in 2017 increased by 155%. In Mozambique, downloads of the Bible app increased 243%. And in Angola, downloads of the Bible app increased 733%. Listen, my brothers and sisters, I'm encouraged to know that these facts and trends indicate that more and more people around the world, when they are facing discouragement, when they are dismayed, they are turning to the Bible. As a matter of fact, many in Facts and Trends and Lifeway noted that 2017 was the year of the Bible. As a matter of fact, Bobby Grunewald, who is the innovation pastor at Life Church, he said, "We believe the Bible is an enduring source of courage and strength." He often says, and he's also the founder of the YouVersion Bible app, he says, "We are encouraged to see that from this year's data, that more people all over the world are finding hope in God's Word." I don't know about you, but that encourages me. Because it lets me know that more and more people down around the world are realizing that you can trust in riches and you can trust in land, but the only one you really can trust in and depend on is God. As a matter of fact, you won't find this story on CNN, you won't find it on MSNBC or Fox News. But there was a museum that was opened in our nation's capital on November the 17th. It is called the Museum of the Bible. It opened in our nation's capital on November the 17th. It was funded and it was brought about by Steve Green, the president of Hobby Lobby. That museum cost $500 million. And in our nation's capital, a place where, my brothers and sisters, the Bible and prayer have been put out of everything else, God worked everything out for good. Invite people to engage the impact and history of the Bible. I'm encouraged. Joshua 1 and 9, my brothers and sisters, says, "Be thou strong and of good courage, because the Lord your God goes with you." What does the new year hold for you? Is there any way for you to know? One way is to look at probabilities and predict. Another way is to look at what you believe about God and life and have faith.
All right.
Listen, you only have two choices as you transition to a new year. You can look at probabilities and predict, or you can go into what you believe about God and have faith. I don't know about you, but I'm going to go with faith and not predictions and probabilities. Listen, where do you fall in line? There's a man that faces the new year. He's edging, he's apprehensive, but determined. He feels alone and scared. And because he feels alone and scared, he enters the new year ruthless. Every man for himself. But maybe you're like the woman who's unconcerned about the prospects of a new year like everything else in her life. She simply lives for today, not worrying about tomorrow. There is an emptiness and lack of meaning in her life, and so she evades everything and throws caution to the wind. If you would ask her her New Year's resolution, she would say, "Que sera, sera. Whatever will be, will be." Or maybe you're like the man who's been ill for the last 6 months. You've kept it a secret, afraid to go see the doctor. You believe that if God willed for you to be okay, you'd be okay. If not, what is it good to see a doctor? When my time is up, my time is up. If God wills, I'll be all right. Maybe you're like that young mother. She has not much to look forward to in the new year. She looks back with much regret and says, "If only I had done it differently." She withdraws more and more. She believes that life happens to her while she agonizes over every bad decision she's made. She prays, but she never finds God will. She believes that God will help her if she does the right thing. Which one are you? Which man? Which woman are you? What will happen to you in the new year? Listen, my brothers and sisters, we need to understand that what happens to you in the new year is not simply the result of what life brings to you or what happens to you. It will be the outgrowth of what you believe and what you know about God. How you know God works life out in your situation. Where will you be at the end of 2018? You need to understand that where you are at the end of 2018 will be a reflection of what you believe about God, what you believe about His creation, and what you believe about yourself. How is God involved in shaping your life? As you move into 2018, you've got to make some decisions about who you think God is. Do you think God is an absentee landlord who simply tells you good luck and then leaves you for the rest of the new year? Do you think God is a clockmaker who simply winds up the clock and lets it run out on you? Do you think God is a puppeteer who simply wants to manipulate you in 2018? Or maybe you think God is a stern judge who wants to punish you for every wrong and every bad decision you make. It's these crucial questions that make us wrestle with the doctrine of providence. Seward Hiltner says that grasping the idea of providence in its proper meaning is the most important thing that can be said about God. How God wishes to be involved in your life in 2018 helps you to understand what providence is all about. We need to understand that providence is not a problem to be solved, but it is a mystery to be lived. The key to providence is understanding the unique God who stands behind providence. We see providence at work in three very unique stories. We see providence at work in the Abraham event. In Genesis chapter 12, verses 1 through 3, we find that God providentially calls Abraham out of Ur of the Chaldees. He tells him to leave where he is and goes to a place that he does not know about. All of us are like Abraham because we are entering into a new year that we know nothing about. All we can do is trust God. But listen, God, when he called Abraham from Ur of the Chaldees in Genesis chapter 12, verse 1 through 3, God entered into an operation that continues to exist today. That's called Operation Blessing. He said, through you, Abraham, I want to bless all the nations of the earth. Now, here's what I want you to understand. God does not change. He's the same yesterday, today, and forever. And so Operation Blessing is still God's plan. Now listen, you need to understand that God wants to bless the entire world through one son by the name of Jesus Christ, through that seed that would come through Abraham. In Operation Blessing, we see that God continues to do the same thing down through the years. God is a God of purpose. He had purpose for Abraham's life. He had power to bring about the purpose in Abraham's life, and he also had patience to deal with Abraham when Abraham was not doing what God wanted him to do. But then we see God's providence at work in the lives of the nation of Israel, because God called Israel out of Egyptian bondage and led them into the promised land. God had a purpose for Israel. God had power to bring Israel's purpose to pass. God also had patience with Israel when they would not do what God wanted them to do. But then we also see Operation Blessing coming to its full fruition through Jesus of Nazareth. Because we see in Jesus of Nazareth, God has a purpose. And God had the power to bring about his purpose through the Lord. But we also see that the patience that he had with Abraham, the patience he had with the children of Israel, he didn't have to have patience with his son. He had to have patience with those of us whom his son died for. Saw a very interesting story the other day about a young brother who ran to his father. And he ran to his father because a pack of ferocious pit bulls had attacked his brother. Attacked him so much that his brother didn't make it. He ran home to get his daddy. His daddy got his gun and came out, and you know what his daddy did? He killed those dogs. And as I read that story, I thought to myself, if somebody did that to my sons or my grandsons, if somebody killed my grandson or my son, I'd want to kill him. But the good news is that God was not like that. Because the Bible says that all of our sins were on his son. We killed his son, but he didn't kill us. God, I'm bringing me here today. And that's what grace is all about. a show that came out a few years ago. Don't think it's still on, called Early Edition. And in Early Edition, the host would get the next day's newspaper, and the host would read it. And he would show the upcoming news. He would read the newspaper about tomorrow and relate it to viewers today. Because he had tomorrow's newspaper, he had information that nobody else did. The fact of the matter is, Providence says, my brothers and sisters, that the Bible is God's plan. And God has information that nobody else has. And we can move forward into tomorrow knowing that God knows tomorrow and God is holding our hand. We might not know tomorrow's headlines. We might not know headlines 6 months from now. But Providence says that God goes on ahead of us. And God already knows what's coming before we get there. So we ought to hold to God's unchanging hand and trust that God will provide for us in advance. God ultimately provided for us in advance some over 2,000 years ago on the cross when he provided the provision of his son Jesus Christ to be the Savior for our sins. And so on this, the last day of 2017, it is not promised for any of us to transition into 2018. And so on today, if you have not embraced Christ as Lord and Savior, you need to come and give us your hand and give God your heart while the blood is still running warm in your veins. God will give you providence for a new year. If you trust and never doubt, he'll bring you out of that life of sin and bring you into the marvelous light. As we stand, the doors of the church are open.